over to Holly.
Okay, good evening, everyone. I'd like to call this regular meeting of the Board of Selectmen for Monday, February 24th, to order. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. First Selectman's report. I'll be brief this evening as I just... Sorry. Pardon? No. Can we... what I would like to do first is we will follow the agenda in order and then I'll do some agenda movement here. How about that?
Yep.
Okay. So my report will be brief this evening. As many of you read in the news this morning, the markets have reacted quite in an interesting fashion to the coronavirus. Some of that might be social media and media driven, but in light of that, we're going to convene a meeting of our emergency response team in the next few days to begin to talk about what a local response would be. There's no imminent threat here for us locally, but we certainly want to be prepared. So more information will be coming forward about that shortly. Kate.
Department heads have all been responding to me what their plans are for the flexible hour trial period this summer. So I think everybody, there's only a couple that haven't gotten that into me, but we look in good shape. Departments are planning, and we'll start doing more of a public push about it in April.
Okay.
That's it.
Perfect. I'll entertain a motion to amend our agenda to add a presentation by the depot. Krista moves. May I have a second? Sarah seconds. All those in favor? Aye. Great. So please, friends from the depot, come forward.
So we are kids from Cops and Kids. So Cops and Kids is just an organization where kids and cops get together like once a month and you do various activities. You work on basically leadership and not skills with them, but like just like making you become more comfortable around them. Oh, I'm Arthur Cummins.
Thank you.
But you learn leadership, you learn how, you learn more responsibility, you learn that like cops are not all like bit like bad and no, not bad, but
it's good they're sitting right next to you.
That are not all like very tough, and they really try to make you more comfortable around them, so you're not, because some people like fear them or something, but yeah, it helps you overall with skills on how to be a better person and how to like just overall be more comfortable around people in general.
Thank you.
I'm Cece Cummins, and this is my second year doing Cops and Kids. And at first, when I heard about the program, I was like, okay, it sounds interesting. I'll get to know some of the cops in Darien. And as Arthur said, you learn a lot of wonderful things, but you get to know the cops, and you get to know that they're here to help you. And I think sometimes kids find cops intimidating, but they're really not. They're here to help you, and they're just nice people to talk to if you ever need anything. But we do a lot of fun activities, and we learn so many things about what the police officers do in the town. And it's really interesting. Like, you learn a lot of stuff that you wouldn't know about a police department. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. I've been doing Cops and Kids for 3 years, and as me and the other kids have learned to know the cops, they've become positive role models, and we put a different perspective on what we think about the cops. I now feel comfortable approaching the police officers and find myself thinking back to the lessons they've taught me all the time about honesty, teamwork, respect for others, and drugs, vaping, and alcohol. This program has significantly affected me. Thank you.
Can you tell us your name, please?
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. My name is Connor.
Hi, Connor. Thank you. We really appreciate hearing from you about Cops and Kids. We haven't heard about Cops and Kids from the kids for quite some time, so we very much appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
Okay. Is there anyone else for Cops and Kids who would like to say a few words? Janice or Court? Or is Allie back there?
Cardwell.
Okay. You thought you could get away with sitting in the back. Janice, you have to come up here. Thank you.
Everybody up.
Great.
Court and I started Cops and Kids 11 years ago.
Can you introduce Court for us? Because we don't see him too often.
This is Officer Court Isaac.
Thank you.
He's the motorcycle cop, everybody knows. And this is Lieutenant Allison Hedema. Allison works with us with Cops and Kids. They both have been in our Cops and Kids program for the full 11 years. Allison also runs Respect Works with the Darien Domestic Abuse Council. She runs the kids at the depot, and she also is in GNO Girls Night Out as a facilitator for Girls Night Out. We originally got a grant from the Office of Policy and Management for $10,000 a year for the program, which was a big, long grant, and Court did it. We had to answer to them for 3 years. It was really hard. We had to go out of upstate a lot of times and to do stuff with them, but at any rate, the program has more than paid off. The kids that first started Cops and Kids are juniors now in college. And they remember the cops. They come back to town. They look for the cops that they knew. Kids that have gone through Cops and Kids will go find a cop if they have questions. It's made a really big impact. It's made a very big impact on the kids.
It's for middle schoolers, right, Jess?
Yes, only okay. Middle schoolers. We started out with high school and found out that they know everything. So we went straight down to middle schoolers. And I can't tell you, thank you for the help. Thank you, Chief. Thank you to your police department for helping us with this program. And thank you for helping us with this program. And we'd like to bring the kids to talk more because they really do have a lot to say about the program.
That's awesome.
And we'll see you Saturday at bowling?
Perfect, yes.
Okay.
I'd like to hear from Court and Allie, too,
sure.
To hear from your perspective about Cops and Kids, if you don't mind.
Sure. Well, like I said, we've done it for, I don't know, 10, 11 years now. Initially, it was started pretty much as a whim. But then when you deal with some of these kids, you see how it changes their lives, and you have the parents come up to you and say these real positive things. It hits to the heart. So that's why we wanted to fight to try to keep it going, because you see the changes in these people and the bridges it develops. So we try to stick it out every year, come up with different things, get new kids, and just try to keep passing it on.
And about how many kids participate in the program currently?
We average about 20, 22 right. Sometimes, okay. Right in the ballpark of there. And then we'll have, you know, 6 to 8 cops that are involved with it that come at random times, you know, because everybody has lives. But so that way we try to have all these different cops that can come, at least a few are there for every event. And it gives them exposure to different people outside of the uniform and more of a personal level.
And this is on your own time, right? This is not during your shift hours, correct?
No, this is off-duty.
Yeah.
Yeah, all the events are off-duty events, which sometimes people can't make certain things, mm-hmm. So that's the problem because, you know, the police department runs 24/7. But, yeah, it's always off-duty. You're plain clothes 99% of the time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Allie, do you have anything you'd like to add?
Sure. I just like to say my favorite part of it is just – like seeing these kids outside of it, and then like tonight, I was like, Connor, and I gave him a big hug. Like, you really do form relationships with these kids, and so when you're in it 10, 11 years, and you see them out in the street, you're like, oh my God, hey, how are you? And you talk, and it just brings a different perspective to them that, you know, it's like when you're little and you go to school and you think your teacher lives at the school and you never see them, and then you see them at the grocery store and you're like, oh my God, my teacher. It's the same concept with us. I think they have this idea that we're just cops 24/7, and then we show up in our you know, regular clothes and we're bowling with them or we're, you know, doing the ropes course with them and they're like, oh my God, and we're scared on the top of the tree and oh my gosh, you get scared. It just brings a different light to how they feel about police and that we're just normal humans like everyone else. And it's nice to build that relationship. And when we see them out, you know, at school or at the grocery store or driving down the street and now they wave, like it makes us feel good, you know? That's what I like about it.
Thank you, appreciate that very much. Well, thanks very much for being here. We love hearing from all of you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, we'll move on to new business. Discuss and take action on a request to approve certain easements. So we have Jeremy Ginsburg, Planning and Zoning Director, and Ed Gentile, Director of Public Works, here this evening to talk to us about the easements that we need in order to make improvements at the West Ave and Noroten Ave intersection. Good evening.
Good evening. Jeremy Ginsburg, Planning and Zoning Director. Ed Gentile, Public Works Director, is with me here to talk about the grant we received. It's called a LOTSIP grant, which has allowed us to proceed with drawings for the Noroten Avenue, West Avenue intersection improvements. The improvements will be some lane widenings, some two new left turn lanes, one going north, one going west, some widening of the curb lines to allow trucks to get in and around that intersection a little bit better. As part of that, we've had to widen the street, which requires us to get an 8-24 report from the Planning and Zoning Commission on road widening, but it will also allow us to move the sidewalks back a little and replace the sidewalks. As part of this road widening and sidewalk replacement, we've needed easements from 8 different property owners near the intersection. Some are permanent easements, some are temporary easements. And in order to determine what would be appropriate remuneration for the property owners, we hired an outside appraiser who did an analysis of all 8 properties with the various easements. And we reached out to the property owners, explained to them what the appraiser has determined for an appropriate amount of the term they used was damages. And we've come to an agreement with the 8 property owners on the remuneration that they will receive. The total for the 8 properties is about $64,000. So the easements are in your packets. Attorney Wayne Fox has assisted us with the resolutions you have before you. The next step would be for the property owners to sign the easements. Then, in the meantime, we'll be going before the RTM in March. The easements will eventually be signed and notarized by First Selectman Jamie Stevenson on your behalf. We then go to DOT for the final plan review, approval, go out to bid, and start construction later this year. Ed, I think you said this is about a 6-month project. So once we start, which may be, weather permitting, May, June, maybe we can have the project done before Thanksgiving, we're hopeful. But a lot depends on that final review by DOT. So we're here tonight to answer any questions you have about these 8 easements. There's a mix of permanent and temporary, and they're small pieces of various properties, enough to allow us to slightly widen the road, move some sidewalks back, do a little regrading, and come up with a intersection that flows better.
Seven. We have 7.
7, thank you.
Yeah, that's what I was. That's
so,
what I was going through the memo.
So,
why didn't you hit me in the back?
You were on a roll.
7.
You were doing well.
So we all know very well, certainly there's been a lot of discussion about this particular intersection for a variety of reasons lately, and we know that this is a long-anticipated project. It actually goes back to the redevelopment of the old Allen O'Neill. And this was planned back at that point in time, so I'm glad that we're here. Can you talk a little bit about the dollars? Can you talk about the LOTSIP grant itself? You know, we approved our local match some time ago for this project, and can you also remind me if the easement acquisition is included in the, we'll purchase the easements out of the grant funding, is what I'm trying to say.
Yes. Ed's going to follow up on this, but the bottom line is the town of Darien pays for the design costs. So we had to pay an engineer and a traffic person to study the and do counts, and all that's on the town's dime. The grant pays for right-of-way acquisition, including this $64,000, and the various construction costs, which we believe is about...
1.175.
Right. There's a certain formula that DOT requires us to use in terms of estimating the job, so we've had to pay our engineer to do estimates. The estimates were reviewed by DOT, and as the plans change or get tweaked or whatever it is, DOT will do a final run of the estimated work to be done. And of course, prices change as well throughout this multi-year project, so they'll make final adjustments.
The estimate that we proposed to the DOT had escalators in it, depending on the number of years it was taken to get approval. I think we're right on the outside of that right now. The estimate also threw in contingencies for incidentals. There were parts for utility relocation, so and they give you a range to pick from, like 2% to 7%, and generally speaking, we picked the higher end of it, not knowing what we'd had to do at first. What funds we get back will be the bid. Okay. First, they'll also approve the easements that we have, and when they approve the easements, they'll approve the damages that we're going to pay them, along with our appraisal costs and our costs for our attorneys. At that time, that'll be included with our low bid. So after we bid it, we get that number too. We put all of that together, and they will give us a check after they've approved the low bidder. And at that point, these easements will be filed on the land records, and the property owners will get the money for the easements.
Okay. I want to make sure that funding component gets added into the documentation that gets sent through the process and ultimately to the RTM.
That's correct. It's important, and we've had numerous discussions about this, that we get reimbursed for this $63,900-some dollars. But it's also important, as Ed has noted, that we don't disperse any funds until we're certain the project's going to get final approval from DOT and the check arrives from DOT in the town of Darien.
Okay.
And that's when the easement becomes.
And then that's when we'll file it.
Right.
Because you don't want to file something and DOT says, for whatever reason, there's a change in the project.
Right.
We're right one step forward, two steps back. So it's important to kind of, we want to move it along, but we have to wait for certain milestones like final DOT approval.
And they've already lost on them. We saw these plans at 30%, and there weren't any significant changes to 90. It's just a matter of putting in details and specifications for your construction documents.
Okay. For those who are listening from home, we did have extensive discussions in executive session about the enhancements to pedestrian safety amenities that will go hand in hand with this intersection improvement. Questions in public for Jeremy and Ed?
Oh, we're grateful that this work is going to be doing. And just there'll be communication, obviously, with the public and the school system regarding this construction, because it'll impede, as we probably assume, you mentioned Thanksgiving, students and walking in that
right.
area.
Right. Ed and I were just talking about that within the past week in terms of trying, while it would be ideal to get as much done in August, we have to be sensitive to the school schedule. So we were talking about making the low bidder, the final contractor, aware of such sensitive times to try to avoid conflict as much as possible.
And see if we could direct him to do certain areas first. So when Jeremy says it's a 6-month construction period, that doesn't mean we'll have that whole intersection dug up for 6 months. There's long lead items that we have to order, installation of traffic signals, bed signals, and so on. Adding though that timeline in also, that kind of extends the schedule to where you're looking at 5 or 6 months worth of work.
And how is this information getting communicated to the administration of schools?
We will be in contact with, as we always do with our projects,
okay.
the Board of Ed, Police Department, Fire Department,
okay.
making sure they're aware of everything that's going on out there with regards to any type of detours, or any type of road closures, any changes to that intersection that could impact using that intersection properly.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
No. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. So we have 7 easements to approve this evening. And we will start, we're going to do them individually because they're all slightly different. So we're going to start with the draft temporary and permanent easement for 179 Norotan Avenue. And with your, without objection, I'd like to waive the reading of the resolution. Okay. So I will entertain a motion to approve the draft resolution of the Board of Selectmen for the Town of Darien to accept a temporary and permanent easement over property located at 179 Norotan Avenue.
So moved.
Okay, may I have a second? Sarah? All those in favor? Okay, thank you. And again, without objection, waive the reading of the resolution of the board to accept a temporary and permanent easement over the property located at 173 Norotan Avenue.
So moved.
Kip moves. May I have a second? Sarah seconds. All those in favor? Okay, thank you. Waive the reading of the resolution to accept a temporary and permanent easement over the property located at 180 Norotan Avenue.
So moved.
Kip moves. May I have a second? Sarah. All those in favor? Thank you. Waive the reading of the resolution to accept a temporary and permanent easement over the property located at 185 Norotan Avenue.
So moved.
Okay, Sarah. All those in favor? Okay, thank you. And waive the reading for the resolution to accept a temporary easement over the property located at 187 Norotan Avenue. David.
Wow.
may I have a second? Sarah. All those in favor? Okay, thank you. Waive the reading of the resolution to accept a temporary and permanent easement over the property located at 242 West Avenue.
So moved.
Kip moves. May I have a second? Sarah seconds. All those in favor? Okay, thank you. And waive the reading to accept a temporary and permanent easement over the property located 1 Allen O'Neill Drive.
So moved.
Kip moves. Sarah seconds. All those in favor? Okay. Thank you. I want to thank our staff very much for all of their hard work on this. What many people don't realize is these LOTSIP grant applications and approval process works its way through WESCOG. And it's somewhat competitive with our member communities within WESCOG, and Jeremy and Ed have done a fantastic job to be responsive to the needs of the planners at WESCOG and the experts at DOT. So I want to thank you very much for your work on this. And I know there's more coming, so we appreciate that in advance. Thank you. Okay, discuss and take action on a request to approve the summer sidewalk sales days, which are planned to be this year from July 9th to July 11th. Is there anyone here from the chamber this evening? I don't see anyone. No? We love the chamber sidewalk sales, and I will take a moment since we have our chief and our captain here this evening, just for me to publicly acknowledge a little bit of concern I have if portions of the properties along the Post Road and Corbin Drive are under construction this summer during the sidewalk sales. I hope that there can be some coordination between the chamber and the police department so that as we have people moving from one side of the Post Road to the other, that they can be assisted in doing that safely. So does anyone have any questions about this year's? Yes,
I do. As we're referencing the letter dated February 19th from David Keating, I guess that's what we're voting on. I was just wondering, why was it phrased in the third bullet, tents may be set up, blah, blah, blah. The tents will be removed on or by Monday, July 13th, where I don't mean to be nitpicky, but that means it could be midnight on the 13th, and I understand the nature of the request was that they be done by the morning of the 13th. So is there a way we can clarify that? I'd like to see them down personally by Saturday night, if this is going to be quite a busy area, or just tighten up when we expect the tents to be down.
We can certainly make that request. I don't know if, Jeremy, if you have any insight on why Dave gave them until Monday.
Could be the tent companies and when they are available.
Okay, that's a... So it's a little bit different than what we said the morning of, the end of day. I just want to clarify.
Some of it is, most of it's the tent companies calling them and getting them to come as soon as possible. Some of it's also weather. But in the past, we have not had any problems with the takedown of the tents. Okay. Usually by early on Monday is my recollection. Everything's cleaned up, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So from that standpoint, we've been very fortunate. Okay. Susan Cater and her predecessors have been very helpful in keeping things moved along, get back to normal, I'll call it. But okay. I guess we could also make a request to say, you know, the sooner the better, kind of in a nice tone of voice.
Yeah, I don't recall if the tent companies actually come out Saturday late afternoon after the event is over, and I don't believe that they come out on Sunday.
That's fair.
Some may, but Monday's really they're open for business day to come and collect their materials.
Okay.
Thank you, Jeremy.
Thank you.
Any other questions about sidewalk sales?
How do we manage the enforcement issues? Referencing the last paragraph, we talked about making sure that the participants that are not part of the chamber program don't hold sales. So how does that process work?
It's a good question. It happens, I don't want to say every year, but many years. Susan Cater, or again her predecessor, Carol Wilder Tammy, or whoever it may be, will call us with a, hey, I see someone's here. They're not chamber members, but they're starting to set up. And what we respond to them is, look, explain it to them. If you're having trouble, we would gladly go over there or call them or work with them. But it's always a little nicer coming from the chamber to say, look, here's the situation. All these other people have paid. They're dues-paying members of the chamber, and 99.9% of the time it works itself out where the person says, okay, I'll pay up, or, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't know. Usually the way it works is we rely on the chamber to be the lead in the enforcement, but we're there to back them up if needed.
But really, Jeremy, the truth of the matter is that if there is a retailer, let's say, I can understand if someone wants to come in who's not a Darien business owner necessarily, or has a bricks and mortar shop and they're trying to set up a tent in the downtown, that's a little bit easier to enforce. But if we have retailers downtown who maybe they're not having a quote unquote sidewalk sale inside, but might be having a sale inside, we're really not going to prohibit them from their regular dealings.
You're absolutely
dealings,
right. We have had calls in the past, hey, so-and-so, we're having the sidewalk sale, but so-and-so retailer has a sign on their window, sale. We say, hey,
yep,
that's fine. That's okay.
Correct.
Are they set up on the sidewalk? No. Okay, then that's just a typical retailer having a typical sale. Or some retailers will put the word sidewalk sales inside. Or we have a great sale inside. We, again, that, as long as they're not set up out on the sidewalk, that from a zoning standpoint, they're okay.
Right. You know, and we want to respect the relationship certainly between the chamber and their members and the chamber and non-members, because participating in the sidewalk sales is a financial concern. You have to pay to participate. You also then have to pay to bring tents in and set up tents. So for some retailers, you know, it's a business decision on whether they want to actually be involved in that.
And some retailers can't legally be out on a tent on a sidewalk. I'm thinking of like liquor stores. Mm-hmm. And so they want to enjoy the ambiance. There's more people on the street certainly at those times, but they legally can't do that. So they have to make other provisions inside their store. And there's other stores that frankly have so much stuff it would overwhelm. And so not everyone participates. I think it's great for the chamber because I think they get a lot of members, and it's really a benefit to the members to participate because we've all been out on nice weather days. They really do great business, and it's really a nice thing to have out in the community. But there are always folks that, for whatever reason, can't participate.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, so we have a motion here. The Board of Selectmen of the Town of Darien hereby grants permission to the Darien Chamber of Commerce for Darien Sidewalk Sales and Family Fun Days to take place from July 9th 2020 to July 11th, 2020, subject to the conditions detailed in the February 19th, 2020 letter from the zoning enforcement officer. I'd like to make a slight amendment to this motion to simply acknowledge that the Board of Selectmen desires for the chamber to work with the Darien Police Department to formulate a public safety plan for pedestrians. And that can take whatever form, you know, is mutually agreeable.
To work with the police to?
To formulate a plan for pedestrian safety during the sidewalk sales.
Thank you. Need a motion on the,
So may I have a motion to approve the amendment first. Okay, Krista moves, David seconds, all those in favor? Aye. Okay, and now I'll entertain a motion to approve the motion. Krista moves, Sarah seconds, all those in favor? Great. Okay. Discuss and take action for a special appropriation for the police department station maintenance. Glad you're here for this one, gentlemen. Okay, just to set the stage a little bit, as we all know, we've had continuing challenges with the HVAC system at the Darien Police Department. And what we're discussing tonight is a potential transfer from fund balance of $233,429 to help fund HVAC equipment and management system. And I'll turn it to the chief.
Good evening. I'm Don Anderson, the chief of police. As the board may know, in 2011, the town of Darien funded a sizable expansion and renovation of the police department. That was completed in 2012 when full occupancy came about. I was promoted to the administrative services captain in November of 2013. So my involvement in the actual construction and or early planning stages of the police department building was minimal. My recollection is the only thing really I was asked about the police department building was if I thought the green or the blue carpet and window wall treatments were better. So I inherited that in 2013. Since that time, I've spent an inordinate amount of time on HVAC issues within the Darien Police Department and no insignificant expense as well. Really, the precipitating cause of really where we had to do something was I was on the roof with the contractor on a Friday night, and I was standing in front of the condenser unit. He left to go do something, and for some reason I moved from in front of the condenser to the side of the condenser just prior to it exploding, and it would have caught me right in the face with the glass and the molten metal, and we had to go that entire weekend with no air conditioning in the building. So since that time, they have, you know, they get it back working again, but sustained operation of our HVAC system in our building, which is the only 24/7, 365 building in the town of Darien, has been marginal at best. I think we've been very circumspect and as agreeable as we can with our existing vendor. Since 2013, when I inherited the Administrative Services Bureau and therefore the overseeing the building, it has just not been a sustained success of that HVAC system. With the assistance of the DPW folks, we have crafted a plan and crafted charted the course to get this squared away. From a layman's perspective, I asked the vendors that came in, is it too much to expect that we could set the thermostat to 70 degrees in the Darien Police Department like we do in our homes and expect the HVAC system to work around the clock 365 days a year, no matter whether it was winter or summer? And the vendor's reply was, that's absolutely within the realm of what you should expect the system to do. Our system currently does not do that. There are times in the summertime when we have seen temperatures in the 90s in the report room. There's been times when the break room where officers are eating their meals in the wintertime that it is 40 degrees, and repeated dozens and dozens and dozens of calls to the HVAC service company to try to keep us just reasonably comfortable in that building. The nuts and bolts of how this all works, I defer to the experts, but I do believe that we have developed a plan and a chart to go forward, so this, we're not talking about this. For an administrative services captain or the chief to be spending maybe 25 or 30% of their time on HVAC issues in the building is just problematic. When Dave Sabini was hired on from the town to oversee building maintenance in all town buildings, we made a quantum leap forward. At least we had somebody to call right away, and we had someone that could come, as in Ed and Tony as well, that when we're talking to these vendors, they're talking the language, right? So we're not going to get snowed by things that, as a police officer who was hired to walk the beat and give out parking tickets, really didn't understand. But in the last 7 years, you know, the only other thing I could have gone and went to Apex Tech and the HVAC service, because I kind of speak the language now of why this should work and why it doesn't work. Our current building management system, the brain of this whole operation, in medical terms, we need a cardiologist and a neurologist, because the brain and the heart, neither one of them are working optimally. So both of these things work hand in hand, and they both have to be replaced. Our current building management system is a proprietary system. It was proprietary to the company who put it in, and our folks here cannot adjust the temperature or access the system to make any kind of changes. So when the system is bringing in 100% humid air from the outside, and we have rain coming out of our air conditioning registers onto the captain's and the chief's desks, our guys here in Darien can't come and immediately push some buttons to get that from happening. The system that we're asking for the transfer for is an open source, non-proprietary system that our folks here in Darien can master and operate, I mean, access remotely to fix these issues when they come up. There shouldn't be very many issues. Anybody knows me, I don't like to spend money on stuff that really shouldn't have to be replaced, especially in an 8-year-old building. In this case, I have no, you know, hesitation to come here and say this needs to be done. Unfortunate but true. I really don't think we can go through another summer with the issues that we've had and the ongoing, especially on weekends. It seems to happen on weekends at the least opportune inopportune time to get this done.
If I could ask, I think Tony might be the right guy to ask. Tony, you come up and introduce yourself.
Sure. Hi. Tony Campanella, DPW Supervisor, Facilities and Equipment.
Thank you. Do you have familiarity with the automatic logic system, the UT
technology? Yeah, so the automated logics, which we're proposing to put in the police station, is what we use here at Town Hall for both our heating and cooling.
The new system
you're putting
in? The new system. Well, we currently have the new system at the police station.
It's the same as what we have here.
It's the same as what we have here at Town Hall.
The one that's working so well here?
Correct. Yes, the control system that's working.
The control system is not the problem here.
Correct.
Oh, okay. Thank you. All right. Wait a minute. We're looking confused.
Good point.
Right. You know, there's lots of parts to an HVAC system. Okay. The control system is working great. There are some mechanical systems that are quite old that are on the docket to get replaced, but the control system is really top notch, and anyone in the industry would agree with me there.
Does this product come with any kind of a warranty so that you can get in, install it, use it, see how it's working, and see if the combination of the new BMS with the condensing unit is in fact the answer to the problems?
Truthfully, I don't know the specifics of the warranty. I assume it's you know, like a lot of things, is 1 year, I mean, that's what these products are made to do. You know, we've had experience with these, and they work. It's an open source. It's continually supported, the product in the police station now. When they put it in, it almost immediately became unsupported. So our confidence is high with the automated logic system.
And so, just so, I don't profess to know much about building management systems, But you have a building management system today that is outdated, unsupported, and you can't be as responsive as you need to be. And you need a new building management system. But is the building management system really the only thing that is, the condenser obviously needs to be replaced, but it sounds like there's maybe other fundamental things in this system that are problematic, and I just would like your assurance to feel a little bit more confident that this tremendous investment is going to get us to where we need to be.
I think that the control system is the major, the major problem. If there are a mechanical issue here or there that may exist, it's almost impossible to pinpoint those with the giant problems the control system. So the control system does lots of things. It's not like you turn your thermostat at your house and it comes on, gets hot. It controls outside air, exhaust air. In a commercial building, you have to rotate the air a certain amount of times an hour, and just the temperature. So there's lots of decisions going on as to when to open exhaust, when to bring air in, when to turn the condensers on, when to turn coolers on. The current system has never been able to make those decisions correctly. Yeah.
Can I expand on the SES report and how we're going to put that together with a lot of the things we're going to do over there?
So we had a commissioning report.
Yeah, that was good.
Just talk about all the things that were wrong. A few things came up, mechanical issues that could be addressed separate from the control system, very minor. A strong majority had to do with the control system, the ability to set different set points to make these decisions when to open things up and turn things on, exhaust air and bring air in. So the commission report very much aligns with our experience with the system and recommends moving away from the current system.
So the mechanical ventilation, I understand the need to be able to carefully manage that. And is that how you manage the humidity issue?
Yes.
Or are there other ways, other things about the building envelope that exacerbate the humidity issue in that building?
Well, I'm not sure. I don't think the commissioning report did that. I know there was some question with the building envelope, with some insulation that was done. I don't think I can answer.
Okay.
I think the real problem, as report points out, was the negative pressure.
Exactly.
In the building.
So if we're running on negative pressure and we're pulling in outside air, we can't control the humidity.
And everything goes to hell real fast.
Okay.
Who was the commissioning agent originally? I don't remember.
When the building was built.
Because we, at the school building committee, we searched very hard and wide, and we came back with SES as our commissioning agent for the school.
Okay.
We felt they're the best we could find in the state, and I'm glad you guys use them because they have really top-flight reputation. I don't claim to understand all this report, and I don't understand what comparative enthalpy economizer sequence is, but all those other words, but I think that these guys have the highest reputation. And when they come back with a report, I tend to think that they're going to be the right ones to solve the problem. And we should have had that originally, a good commissioning agent.
And these guys aren't in the business of recommending products or saying, I'd steer away from this product, but without saying it, they're okay with what we're doing.
Okay. So the plan is laid out is to replace the condenser early spring,
yes.
Right?
Yeah.
And then the building management system to be done over the summer.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And the building management system is currently the issue that is, we think, the lead cause of the humidity issues.
Correct.
In the building. All right. So my question would be this. Is there other things that we should do or should be considering doing over the summer? We've already spent the the chief has had to deal with this is mold remediation and various parts of the building. I would hate like heck for the summer to go by, have massive, you know, condensation, humidity inside the building again, get a brand new system installed to take care of the stuff for next year, and yet find out we're in for another mold remediation bill.
Yeah, I mean, we address these problems, you know, kind of on a consistent basis, and sometimes we're able to put a stop to them and say, okay, we've solved this problem in the locker rooms. We solved a problem that had to do with mold on where air was being pushed into the lockers and where it was being exhausted. So things like that we're able to solve. Some of it, the control system, really, it almost doesn't make a difference until the control system is done. But I wouldn't say that we are in any type of dangerous situation where we know of a current issue where it's so wet that we're experiencing mold. And you know, we've had a couple situations where we've addressed it. The spinnaker unit up in the penthouse was leaking
penthouse?
In the gym.
What's that? Exactly.
There any commercial equivalents to what we would all know as a home dehumidifier system that could be used to take some of the humidification out of the building for this coming summer period? Because like I said, we don't know about any mold-related issues currently, but mold is insidious, and you know, once it's gotten into a building, it's very difficult to get it remediated, even if you use a professional company. And my big concern is you're going to have another summer where you have, you know, 80% humidity inside that building for the duration of the summer, and by the end of the summer with, you know, 90-degree heat, 80% humidity, you've got yet again another mold issue. So if there's a way, or if there's any commercial equivalent product to diminish the humidity level in the building for the summer period, is that something that we should entertain at this time?
I can't answer. You know, we certainly can look into that. I'm sure things exist. I don't know where they stand with cost, but it's something that we can certainly look into with our trusted contractors.
Can I ask them a little bit broader question? With this report from last April, and to Kip's point, that's great, that is highly recommended SES, but where are we now then in addressing these four pages of recommendations?
A large portion of those recommendations have to do with the control system, have to do with set points for the control system.
Okay, so would you say after this appropriation, this transfer, we are 90% of this list? Where are we
yes.
on this?
I, once the automated logic system is in, I would say a strong majority, I don't want to put a percentage on it, I would say I wouldn't argue with 90% of that commission report, those line items are covered with the new control system. The proper set points.
So some of the 68 items listed on page 7 may yet be unresolved.
Correct, yes.
How are we moving forward with those outstanding issues?
Well, there is, these are difficult to answer sometimes because some of the, let's say, smaller issues, mm-hmm. there may be an issue with it almost without the proper control system. There's so many other factors working against this issue.
Okay, well then you have to address one before you move
Correct.
Forward, that's fair.
Yes, yeah.
Okay.
So maybe what would be fair to ask is once, hopefully this will be approved, it seems to me that it's very necessary, and hopefully the other bodies that need to approve it will agree. Maybe we could ask for a follow-up report to, you know, see how the installation went, if it was successful, what your experience, hopefully with the new system in at least a portion of the summer season was, and then maybe we'll follow up again after next cooling season just to make sure that we're being diligent about staying on top of the problem.
Yes.
And what is the timing for this? I'm not sure it was clear. I mean, assuming it goes through all the
yes,
bodies.
Yeah, I'm going to have it.
Okay. Thank you, Tony.
Ed Gentile, Director of Public Works. What we're looking to do right now is get the money approved for us to actually get the AC unit in place. All right, that seems to be the most important piece, and as Don has said, we can't go through another summer the way we did last year. So once that thing is approved and in place, we're going to order it, we're going to get it down here. Where I'm looking for, like, somewhere around May, first or so week of May, to get that AC unit replaced, back up, functioning again. It all really depends on the approval from the bodies, through the RTM and you folks, Board of Finance also.
Right.
I do want to hear from the Board of Finance tomorrow, I believe. We're meeting with them to present the same proposal for special appropriation. And then discuss with the vendor whether we should put on order that AC unit. There's a 6 to 8 week lead time right now. It really depends on the weather, so if it does warm up, and it has been warming up, these units tend to be serviced a little sooner, need to be replaced a little sooner, some of them, and causes these to be on back order. I really don't want that to happen. So we're going to try to jumpstart it a little bit. We won't purchase or buy anything until the approval from the RTM is passed. The worst thing that could possibly happen is that we call our vendor and say, no, thank you. I do hope that I don't have to do that. I feel that the RTM and the Board of Selectmen and Board of Finance have always been receptive to handling our facilities properly. Now, as far as the automated logic project goes, we want to jumpstart that as soon as we possibly can. As soon as we can get automated logic in here, get our electrician in, do the wiring to the new sensors, get them in place. I'm hoping sometime during the summer or before it starts to get extremely hot, that we have that system in place and we can start working it. That's the goal. That may take us to June or July, but maybe we'll get July and August with the system and we can address maybe some condensation issues or humidity issues in the building and not wait for a whole full cycle till next year to see if it works. And I think Tony hit on it. Some of these things we won't know on that list are still a problem until that new system is in place. And other ones, I think David's addressed a couple of the mechanical ones already. So we've been working on some of them, but just there's a majority of the list we cannot do anything yet with.
Quick question. One of the things you've referenced is that cybersecurity seems to be an issue with the current system. It's not really discussed how the new system would address that. Does open source mean it can be reached remotely by someone we don't want to begin
with? Well, when we talk about the cybersecurity, it's that the current system works off of, it's like Windows 97 or Windows XP.
Yeah.
It's not supported. It doesn't get security patches. So with the new system, there'll be a computer that can be updated with security patches.
Okay.
So that's really the only comment there
Thank you.
Cyber.
Okay. Krista?
Independent of this, I think it's certainly support this work, but I was a little concerned, or could you help me understand the process? It sounded like the chief was involved a lot in this project, where it's not your training, and we've talked about that with the dispatchers, not your training. How are we going to move forward with this project? Do you feel that this is working the best way, or who's owning this going forward, or how can we get the chief to not be taking so much of this?
Right. Well,
get off the roof, yeah.
I mean, he's had to understand it because it's his building, you know,
okay.
And there's been so many problems. It just doesn't, you know, buildings don't have that many problems, you know.
Or it is what it is, so.
Yeah.
Right.
So going forward, we hope, you know, I think we own it.
Okay.
You know, we're managing the contractors. We want to make sure it's working.
Wonderful.
And all that stuff. But if something goes wrong, he's going to know about it. He wants to know about it if something's wrong. And these things were so wrong, he couldn't just ignore them. You know?
So I think it's worthwhile for the new board members to remember back in history that at the time this building was built, the Public Works Department didn't have as much control and collaboration with the police department. You had your own service providers, you had maintenance person or persons that worked on your facility. And it was a really positive change that we made after the new building was built to have the Public Works take a primary role in helping assist with the facilities.
Yeah.
So I know that will continue.
There would have been no way for me to navigate this last 6 years without the DPW. DPW folks, and Dave Sabini and Tony.
But a big portion of that credit going to Dave Sabini. No offense.
it's usually Dave and I, or Dave and Bob Shredders, on the roof on Friday night at 9:45 with flashlights trying to get some semblance of air conditioning back in the building so we don't have a mutiny, you know, over the weekend.
We can't.
Yeah, that's not appropriate. So,
From a layman's perspective, again, that's always good for somebody like me to give you the layman's perspective. I sat across the table from Automated Logic, and I asked a very pointed but candid question. Are you folks going to come in and give us a product where we are no longer talking about HVAC issues? And the guy looked me straight in the eye and shook my hand and said, with, you know, 95 to 100% certainty, you are not going to be talking about HVAC issues going forward. Kind of like your telephone or your heat of your house. You don't want to talk about it. You just want it to work when you pick it up. And I said, is that too much to ask? And his answer was, that is a perfectly reasonable request from someone who can provide you with this HVAC type activity. What we have been getting has not been that for the last 7 years.
Good. I'm sure you were happy to hear that, as are we. Are there any other questions about this transfer? Okay. So I will entertain a motion to approve a transfer of $233,429 from fund balance to fund the HVAC work that we just heard about. Sarah moves.
Is there any way to request or require the incremental work related to ascertaining whether or not there are humidification issues that need to be addressed as part and parcel of this project prior to the BMS system being fully functional?
Well, I think what I'd like to say about that is we all support our officers and staff working in a healthy environment. So I would like to say that we support if there's a way to dehumidify, if you need to dehumidify as you're doing this work, that we would encourage you to do so. We don't want you to be forced to work in an environment if there's some technology that can make the environment better for yourselves.
Well, there are some of those things that we do on a regular basis, spring and fall. The building management system is not capable of doing it, so we have to have a service call and actually shut mechanical dampers to keep outside air from coming in. The issue sometimes is catching it on that weekend when it's suddenly now 100% humidity. But they do lock down these dampers where it might get a little stuffy in the building, but we're not bringing in 100% humid outside air during that time. That's kind of a trade-off. This new system is supposed to be doing that for us. Is it going to be perfect? I can't stand up here and say that it's going to be perfect temperature, perfect humidity, 365 days a year. But I'm convinced that it will be exponentially better with a system that actually works and that our folks can access in real time to see, not just to see what it's doing, but to manipulate the system to get it to do what we need it to do, at least for that time period until they can get there.
So up until today, you've had to call NCON, and they had to come in and close your dampers.
Yes.
Is that correct?
In the time that I've been the administrative services captain and the chief, we've had service and maintenance contracts with NCON. We paid them over $95,000 in service and maintenance contracts.
Yep.
On top of that, which is not unexpected, they come and do filters, they come and do belts, they make sure the system. On top of that, we've spent almost $50,000 in repairs on a lot of this on the condensing unit.
How much incremental and mold remediation?
A lot of that was done in-house by the DPW folks. They pulled down the wall coverings in the chief's office because everything in the administrative wing had to be removed, sealed, and repainted. Wall coverings did not go back up. We've had Hygienics, an independent testing company, had to come in twice. I'm thinking that those two spots were at least $5,000 between the two times that they were there to ensure OSHA compliance and to make sure that we did, in fact, have a safe building. Most of the mold remediation, though, was done by our in-house staff. So we have to figure out how much time they actually put in, but there was no outside contracting price.
That's right. So it wasn't a $50,000 number?
No. We did have a wall covering professional company come in four or five or six times to re-glue wall covering on, when it was coming down because it wouldn't stick to the wall anymore. That's kind of where we found the mold. We didn't know the chief's office was completely covered behind the wall coverings. Fortunately, that was a couple of chiefs ago when he's still alive and well, so I guess we were pretty good there.
So where are we in the cycle of the NCON contract? Is there time still remaining under the current maintenance contract?
Yeah, it would go to the end of the fiscal year.
Fiscal year, okay. And would you anticipate, if needed, still calling NCON in to do some of that manual work if needed, or will the new company take over? I know it's a little odd as you're bringing in a new vendor and... Right.
I'll defer to Ed with that one, but let me preface my remarks that I have absolutely no aversion to have the candid conversation with NCON.
Okay.
I have given them every opportunity to help us and to chart a course for success for us, and unfortunately that has not occurred.
I just want to make sure that we get what we're due out of the maintenance contract that we've paid for, first and foremost.
As far as filters and belts, I have no aversion to having them coming, but they're going to... If this passes through, I'm going to have the conversation with them that we gave them our best loyalty that we could, and we have to make a change.
Yep. Okay.
Yeah, I was just going to say, with NCON, the regular maintenance will continue the regular maintenance. In terms of bringing them in for issues, it would only be if there was an extreme case and we had high confidence that they could solve it. It hasn't always been the case. But as soon as this new stuff is on, kind of, NCON goes and the new company begins.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. All right. Any additional questions? So we have a motion to approve by Sarah. May I have a second? We'll go with Krista. All those in favor? Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time, everyone. Yes, Jack. Sorry, do you have a question for the gentleman?
Just a comment.
Jack, can you, I'm sorry, can you please come up here?
Jack Davis, 197 Hoyt Street. In order to facilitate the easements, we were having a joint meeting with F&B, Public Works, and Public Health and Safety.
Okay.
Now hearing this, sounds like the same committees would be assigned to that. So I'm requesting, if the police chief and Ed, you don't mind, that we add that to the agenda so we could facilitate getting this through.
I would talk to the moderator and make sure that those are the committees that are assigned, and I think it makes good
being
sense.
Being on rules, I'm pretty sure that's what's going to
happen.
Okay.
Nope.
We've already involved the moderator in some of this.
Thank you, Tony.
Thank you.
Great. Okay. Discuss and take action to accept a gift from the Darien Foundation. So the Darien Foundation continues to be very generous to many in the community, including the town of Darien, and we have a resolution before us to consider accepting a gift of $109,091 to fund a live fire judgment training simulator and a laser scanner to map motor vehicle accidents, as well as to map all school and public facilities to provide training for critical incident response.
I will open the discussion on this. Again, Don Anderson from the police department. I'm going to defer to Captain Bob Shredders, who knows the nuts and bolts of this. But as the board knows, we came to the Board of Selectmen with our budget. Included in that budget was a request for a laser shot live fire system, which we do firearms training with. Our existing system, the PRISM system, is 7 years old. It is no longer supported. In the budget, that was one of the things that was taken out of our capital. The Darien Foundation has stepped up to the plate and agreed to fund that for us. Again, we don't spend an inordinate amount of time talking about firearms training or weapons systems, but in this day and age of law enforcement, it is required. It is a best practice here that we have judgmental shooting and non-shooting. From a risk management perspective, when we have the best equipment and the best training, that is our best chance of success when something starts to go toes up. So I'm very thankful to the Darien Foundation for stepping up to the plate to fund this unit. The FARO system, the other piece of the equipment they've agreed to fund for us, is used in accident investigation. What we currently have now is what's called the total station.
You see surveyors using it a lot. It's an electronic measuring device. Yeah. It's on a pole. You'll see people. The days of the fulcrum and the mirror are over. It's all done by a computer. This measuring device, we can measure basically 3D by staying in one spot in a room. You could come in here and you could map out this entire room standing in one or two spots and get a 3D representation of what that is. It really is a high-tech piece of equipment for not only an accident investigation, but any kind of mapping, crime scene mapping. And part of the caveat that they put forth that we would use that to map out public safety, public buildings or schools, the Darien Police Department would be more than happy to assist in mapping any schools as far as school security or public buildings using this equipment. So I'm going to turn it over to Bob Shredders. He and Allison Hadema were instrumental in working with the Darien Foundation to let them know what our needs were and giving them a presentation to that board.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Captain Bob Shredders. I replaced Chief Anderson as the Administrative Services Captain. Big shoes to fill.
Welcome to traffic duty.
Thank you. So as the chief stated, I was a firearms instructor. We did use the PRISM system for the past 7 years. The trend in law enforcement and the best practices is not only having fundamental firearms training as far as, you know, shooting a score on a target, but it's the judgmental training when it's appropriate to use deadly force and when it's not appropriate. As you can see, you just turn on the TV today and almost every day you hear some type of scenario where shots were fired by officers, and it can become controversial if the wrong decision is made, obviously. So this, I can't express how much, just from a training standpoint, that this type of technology is important to the department. Unfortunately, the PRISM system, that company is no longer with us. It's unsupported. And the cost of us making our own scenarios to input into the PRISM system is very cost prohibitive. It wouldn't be worth it for us to do that. So the chief and I, when we were in Arizona this past summer at a conference, we stumbled upon this laser shot company. And they came to headquarters and they did a demonstration for us and members of the Darien Foundation. It was very impressive. It's basically state-of-the-art training that we can give to the officers. As far as the FARO system, I admittedly, that's in Lieutenant Hadema's wheelhouse. She's on the accident investigation team. I did see a demonstration of the capabilities of this the FARO unit, and it's very impressive what it can do. And it aid us greatly, not just in car accident investigations, but potentially in crime scenes for the Detective Bureau and for school and public safety issues at schools or buildings in town.
Sounds like it will reduce the amount of time that it might take to do accident
to open a road. Sure, it's the ability of this to measure quickly is it's pretty impressive. But it's the accuracy and the intelligence that you're going to get. You know, if you have the officers have to testify in court for, you know, motor vehicle fatalities or to aid a detective in a crime scene, instead of now, if there's a crime scene, a serious crime scene, officers would take pictures and photograph and do video camera of a crime scene. This FARO system can three-dimensionally map it, and you can get a 3D image that you can go in and look at from all different angles, and it's really, really amazing. Yeah.
So just first a comment before I open it up to questions. I believe that the thought of the possibility of this gift was in process when we were adjudicating your budget. And so I believe we removed it from the budget because of the anticipation of receiving this gift.
I'm the guilty one.
Is that, I cut it. Am I making a correct statement?
Yeah, I cut it because I knew there was a possibility.
Okay. So the point in me stating that for the public is I feel confident that the Board of Selectmen would have funded something as fundamental as weapons training system for you. I don't want the public to believe that we as a board don't think that's important, but I am so grateful to the the Darien Foundation for their willingness to step up and fund it for us this year.
I'd like to thank them too. I know Chief Anderson thanked them, but they're very gracious in there. It's really helpful. Mm-hmm. It's very appreciated.
I agree.
This system, it's not just when to shoot and when not to shoot, but it also allows officers to go to a less lethal option. So in the training, you can actually use pepper spray, a taser, a baton, and the images on screen react to you using that less than lethal force. So it's not just firearms, it's the whole force array that officers can turn to make a decision about how they're going to handle a situation. And as you can see in the news with mental health situations and shootings as a result of that, it's very helpful to have that option in the training.
One other thing that's very important on this system, it's a dual type system. Our prison system is a live fire system. You only use live ammunition in the range. Well, the way our range is set up, if the range is as wide as this room and the screen is here, you really can't do live, what you would really do in life, because you can't be shooting at the walls. Mm. Right? This system has a laser component too, with another weaponry set where you're actually not shooting live bullets, where you can move all the way to the place that you want to be to try to realistically simulate that training option.
So it's a portable unit. So theoretically, wherever you have a plain blank wall, you can set the system up and use the laser option. And it comes with an array of different facsimile weapons that you can use to, throughout the scenarios that replace a live firearm. So
something that's always important to us when we accept gifts is what will be the town's obligation for maintenance going forward, and I want to thank you for the detail in the memo. It really sounds like the ongoing maintenance is negligible with this system.
For the laser shot, basically, it comes with over 800 scenarios. So initially, we're going to be good for many, many years. I don't even think, even the past 7 years of the PRISM system, we even came close to, I don't think we even came close to 200, using 200 scenarios over that course of time with PRISM. And you do have the option to buy 25 to 30 scenarios every year, but I can't foresee us doing that initially the first 5 years. And then it's just, we use the laser option, it's just the CO2 tank to get the facsimile weapons to work. It uses CO2 to move the action of the firearm. And then it's just batteries for the controllers and like a bulb, if a bulb goes out, for the projector.
Mm-hmm. And the Faro system is also negligible, about $5,300 every 3 years.
The first 4 years is covered under their warranty, and then after that you'd have to decide whether you wanted to go with the 1 year or the 3 year. I think the most cost effective would be the 3 year. And they have a little caveat in here where if you don't initially take some sort of service contract, you're not going to be able to jump into a contract with them.
Okay.
So I'd like to also thank you for putting that in there, because my questions were this. So if there's no ongoing maintenance for the laser shot?
The laser shot, when it's plugged into the Ethernet, uh-huh. It does automatically update the software for free.
Yeah.
Right.
That's
it's good. Just okay. if you're gonna buy new scenarios, really,
okay.
Which again, not going to be a need to.
Mm-hmm. And then for the Faro, 4 years would come with it, because the 3 years, in addition to the 1 year.
Right, my understanding.
Purchase, and then we wouldn't see this in the budget for 4 years. Is that what?
That's my understanding from Lieutenant Hodami. Yes.
And they were very candid from the Faro company that we may not need the upgrades,
right,
because what the machine does will still be appropriate for what we're using it for. They did say that there's a good possibility that you just choose not to get any upgrades.
Right.
We don't know what 4 or 5 years of upgrades might look like.
Sure. Yeah.
The resolution of what you might get might be exponentially better 5 years out, where it's almost video quality.
Right.
And the gift has a 3 year maintenance in it. Right.
Captain Shutters, there's been a lot of talk this year about school crossing safety with the students walking to and from school. I could be completely off base here, but if the Faro system is really good at creating 3D images of accident scenes, right, is there a potential that we could utilize it to help evaluate school crossing safety routes and intersections and things like that as well, or maybe to help facilitate Ed with where the most, the highest priority, you know, changes in sidewalk or crossing might be for the students.
Basically, anything that could be measured can be measured by this unit. So we definitely use it for intersection work or any type of public safety. It can be used to measure.
It sounds like it's a great idea, and I would encourage you all to, you know, chat with Ed about, you know, how he might be able to take advantage of it as well. You know, because he's going to be ongoing looking at replacing sidewalks and school safety issues. So,
Kip, did you have any questions?
No, I just happen to think that the laser system is almost more important than good marksmanship, knowing when to use your weapon and what weapon you're going to use.
Agreed.
I think that's probably the, by far, the more important thing than the guy who has a good eye shot. Mm-hmm. The other part was, I was interested, you talked about school safety in the firearm system, is it? What exactly is that talking about?
So, in worst case scenario, there's an incident at a building in town here, whether it be a school or a business. You can take the FARO system and place it at certain points around the building and create a 3D image. So then we can take our officers or the Southwest Regional SWAT team, which covers Darien, and you can sit down with them in a room and take them through the three-dimensional scene and say, well, you know, maybe we can enter here, or we would, you know, place officers here. You can kind of like plan an approach to a building, or plan a search, how you would systematically go through the building, where to start. Maybe you'd see something you didn't, like different hiding places, and all sorts of different things you can do with it. But we actually, when the salesman from FARO came to give the demonstration to the foundation, he gave us an example of what a police department did with the FARO system, and it was for an event, and it showed the different distances and where they would place officers for security, so it could be used in that type of environment.
So as we're building the Oxford School, it'd probably be something very helpful in planning a security plan.
Sure.
Okay.
Much like Google Street View or Google Maps, where you can drive from here to your home on the computer, you'd be able to drive through the town hall potentially on a computer.
Okay.
Go from entryway up to stairway, look left, look right.
It's like a real estate, if you're looking at real estate online and they have the images and you can walk through the house. It's basically that same type of idea.
Great. Okay.
Krista. So picking up on that same idea without going into too much detail and stop me, so is there a plan then to roll this out in this format within our town?
It's definitely being discussed. We would like to use it in the schools. Lieutenant Hadema stated to the foundation that not only would the accident investigation team be trained in its use, but the detective bureau, and we have specific officers that evaluate the school's safety, and they write the reports, you know, for the schools. So they would also be trained in it. So we'd have an array of different officers in the department that could, you know, be trained in its use, and you know, we can utilize this for the schools, the library, the town hall. And kind of keep it, you know, a library for ourselves.
Right.
Roll it out for trainings and planning. And
okay, great. No, obviously to get this going as quickly as possible and getting these images.
I foresee it getting a lot of use.
Do you see a time when it would be beneficial to have more than one scanner?
I think that's definitely a good idea. I think we'd wait and see after the first year how it works and get everyone trained in it and comfortable with it, and then go from there.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. So we have a resolution before us accepting a gift to the Darien Police Department valued at $109,091 from the Darien Foundation. I'll entertain a motion to approve the resolution. Sarah, may I have a second? Kip, all those in favor? Great. Thank you. And again, thank you to the Darien Foundation. It's a very generous gift.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. Okay, I'd like to go back and add one more item to the agenda that I should have added at the time. So may I have a motion to approve adding to the agenda an item, an 8-24 referral of the easements to the Planning and Zoning Department?
So moved.
Kip moves amending the agenda. May I have a second? Sarah seconds. All those in favor? Aye. So I don't have wording. Oh, here we go. Kate has wording. This is wonderful. Okay. So we have a motion before us pursuant to General Statutes 8-24. The Board of Selectmen hereby refers to the Darien Planning and Zoning Commission for a report on the widening of Narroton Avenue and West Avenue. And we need an 8-24 because we're making modifications to the roadway itself. Any questions about this?
I'm sorry, can we clarify what an 8-24 is?
Sure.
It's a report that Planning and Zoning will do to say whether or not what we're planning, what we want to do is in compliance with the town plan.
Yep.
And okay, thank you.
That's correct. Jeremy Ginsburg, for the record, there's a state statute that requires the Planning and Zoning Commission to give a report, and that report is then received by the RTM. If it's a positive report, it needs 50% vote by the RTM. If it's a negative report by Planning and Zoning saying it's not consistent with the town plan, it needs, I think it's a two-thirds. So we're going to get that report done before it goes to the RTM.
Thank you. Perfect. Thank you very much. So I'll entertain a motion to approve the referral, 8-24 referral.
So moved.
David moves. May I have a second? Sarah seconds. All those in favor? Great. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for being here. We appreciate your time. Okay. Now we have meeting minutes, first from February 10th. I have special meeting. The agenda said.
It should be regular. Sorry.
The first one?
The first one.
So let's amend that.
Okay. Okay, that's the first change. These are regular meeting minutes of February 10th. Any corrections or additions?
Page 3, second paragraph under budget deliberation. The expenditure budget amount is not $4 million. It's
$47,734,918. Good catch. That would have been a headline.
I'm sure everyone would like the mill rate to be set to reflect $4.7 million.
You're so right about that.
It just won't quite work.
Yeah. Any other changes?
Are you, Jamie, on page 2, are you happy with what you said under A?
You would ask that we
yes.
Add some numbers.
Yes, okay. And I think those were presented well this evening.
No, they were tonight. Yeah. I just want to make sure you're happy with how it says.
Yeah.
Okay.
To be perfectly clear, documentation for the maintenance and repair costs. That would be more clear.
Okay.
Okay. I'll entertain a motion to approve as amended.
So moved.
Kip, may I have a second? Sarah, all those in favor? Thank you. We have. Special meeting minutes of February 11th. I'll
so
entertain
moved.
A motion to approve. Kip moves. We have a second. David? All those in favor? Okay, thank you very much. There's no public here any longer, so we'll move on from public comment. Agenda review. Going once.
Okay. Well, the dissemination of packets.
Yes.
I know it's an agenda item, but where do we stand on continuing that? Are we going to continue? Electronic.
We've been training on. I'm trying to play with the votes in here right now. We've been training on the electronic creation of the packets.
Okay.
And I think we still, I have to touch base with IT because we're waiting on one more iPad. And then I think question will be working on how to set up, how you all want to set up the iPads. Do we want a Dropbox? Do we want...
that makes sense.
Yeah, so okay. That you can just go out and grab them.
Mm-hmm.
But if anybody wants to stop getting paper copies, we can stop that at any time, but we're working on a more efficient way of...
I think until we're there, we might need these.
Okay. And I'd like to make sure that we actually get both for one or two meetings until we're all comfortable with the electronic version.
Okay. May I make a request that we try to think about how often we can do double-sided?
Yes.
That as frequently as possible, where appropriate.
Okay, any other items for agenda review? Okay, hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn our regular Board of Selectmen meeting. David moves. Sarah seconds. All those in favor? Aye. Okay, and then I will call to order our Parking Authority special meeting for Monday, February 24th. So, Channel 79, I hope that you are continuing to cover our Parking Authority meeting. We have no public here for public comment for this, and we have new business to discuss our wait list policy. Kate.
Right, so what started this, or what prompted this, is we had somebody who came in after the renewal period. They missed the deadline. They failed to renew their permit on time. And the permit person was unhappy that they would have to go back on the wait list at the bottom. And they suggested that they shouldn't have to. They should be able to get their permit next year was basically how they, you know, get the permit back next year. We don't have any policy that would allow that at this time, so following our past practice, you have to go to the bottom of the wait list. And, you know, of course, there are arguments that they've already been through the wait list and, you know, waited there 7 years or so to get the permit. They shouldn't have to wait again. But absent policy that allows us to bypass the normal procedure, we didn't do it. So I want to raise the issue with you. Is there any appetite among the Parking Authority to have any kind of policy that would allow us to, or allow people who fail to renew on time to not have to wait?
With the window to renew approximately 5 months?
No, it's about 2.5 months.
We send out the letters. You give a notice in what, September, October?
They get the letters in the beginning of October,
right.
And they have until mid-December. And there's actually three different deadlines. There's
right.
One deadline where you pay the base fee.
Right.
Then there's you get another 15 business days
right.
Where you have to pay a $25 late fee. Then there's another 15 business days
right.
Where the late fee. So this person, they weren't the only one. They missed three deadlines.
So the letter went out in October. There were two others. And then mid-December.
We send out the letter in October.
Mm-hmm.
We talk about it. We put signs up in the parking lots. Our parking administrator emails people with permits to remind them that the deadlines are coming. So we do a lot of
handholding.
Yes.
100% outreach. As a parking permit holder, I feel there's lots of notice.
I do too.
Have a wonderful evening.
Thank you very much.
I personally would, you know, if you're asking for my recommendation, I don't think we should make allowances. I think they should go back to the end of the wait list. But you're the board who has to make that decision.
Can we just vest you the discretion to do so rather than us having to make a policy?
I'd rather have a policy because you know, then that's putting a lot on, you know, what mood are we in that day?
Mm-hmm.
What's the person's excuse? And I do, you know, honestly, I do there have been occasions when somebody comes and their reason they missed all three deadlines is so legitimate, we let them renew. But that's rare. And I do feel we do an awful lot to make them aware. We put signs up in the parking lot that are flashing, saying the last day to renew is December, you know, whatever date it is.
How many people would you say on an annual basis fall into this category?
I believe this year there were six people who came in after the deadline,
okay,
and asked us to forgive them.
Okay. Six out of how many permits?
Oh, it's like close to 2,000 permit holders.
Okay. So that's not very many, and I too believe that we provide great customer service in terms of notifications and opportunities, mm-hmm, for renewal. What I'd like to suggest is that, because I don't want to provide more latitude that would exacerbate the condition if people know that they can just go to the top of the wait list. There is a hardship because they're not getting their permit, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So they weren't allowed to renew, and they went to the bottom of the wait list. So it's really a double penalty. So what I'd like to throw out for consideration is that for that handful of people that might have, whatever excuse they have, that we give them one opportunity to go to the top of the wait list. And if they're a repeat offender in future cycles, that they're not afforded that opportunity after the first time.
How many people are on the wait list currently?
There are, I believe, about 1,200 on one and 700 on the other. Leroy West being the lower.
So yeah. 1,900 total. Mm.
To Jamie's point, how many have the six, yeah, have been repeat?
Did it, yeah.
I couldn't tell you that.
Yeah.
But we do, we do make notes. Like if you would have put in the policy that Jamie's suggesting, we would put a note in the individual's file. So that if it happened again the next year, we would know.
No. Bottom of the list, I'm sorry. There's 1,900 other individuals that are on the waiting list, keeping their spot on the waiting list up to date. We provide ample notification to the citizens. It's a small number of individuals. The responsibility is on them. They have to have individual responsibility to take care of it, and this manages the other 1,900 individuals who are waiting appropriately for the system and maintaining their position accordingly. No.
Any other comments?
I agree with both Jamie and David. It's a difficult one. It's having waited myself for 7 years. Yes, frustrating.
Remember, if we put a policy in place, we could have someone who's had, we've had people that have had long-term medical issues.
Yep.
We talk about this all the time in our office about, you wouldn't forget to make your mortgage payment. You would hope you wouldn't forget to make your mortgage payment.
Thank
if
you.
If your parking permit is that important to you, it should certainly be a priority. You should be anticipating when the renewal should be coming. But sometimes the stories are heartbreaking, difficult.
But to Kate's point, those are dealt with, and those are.
But if we put a policy in place, we're not going to be making any exceptions.
Got it. So can you clarify the six? Are there others who had a story, for lack of better words?
They all had a story.
No. Just to clarify, were there 20 in total?
No.
But
six.
14 had a story?
That's what I meant.
Okay.
No.
So six. It's only six.
Right.
Whether they had a story or no story, mm-hmm, there were six. Okay, I just wanted to, if others had stories, that's what I wanted to clarify.
Mm-hmm. I think that if we are going to take a hard line, I have a little bit of a problem doing that. We're a small community, and I think it's I would err on the side of good customer service, but I do appreciate very much taking personal responsibility. I think we're going to have to make it very clear in whatever materials we send out to our, you know, the people who are permit holders that highlighting this new policy that...
Well, it's not a new policy.
It's not a new policy, but we're codifying, yeah. And we're...
And we've done a lot over the years. There, you know, 10 years ago, there was no deadline.
Right. Does Anne call these people? Like, there were six people. Does she look at the people who should have renewed and didn't renew to see that there were six people that didn't?
No, because the six people who didn't, there were more people who did not renew.
Okay.
There were six people who came in.
Okay.
Okay, so the renewal date was December 17th.
Yep.
And there were six people who came in after that date.
Okay.
And said, oh, I didn't renew. Please, you know, I missed the deadline.
Yep.
Please forgive me and let me have the permit still.
How many people in total did not renew?
I would have to check that.
Okay.
It's,
any,
you know,
sense percentage-wise?
Percentage-wise, I'd say number-wise, it's usually somewhere around 20 to 40.
Okay.
It's, you know, not huge numbers every year.
The only thing that sticks in my mind is somehow having permit holders making an affirmative statement that they do not wish to renew.
Hmm.
You know what I mean?
And I don't know how
I don't know how we can accomplish that, but
how about the last 5 days of the renewal period, we email and call anyone who's not yet renewed?
I wouldn't want to call,
yeah.
But emailing, you know, and we have done that. Like, you know, we send out the renewal letters. And then they get an email after that.
I was just using the calling to be as invasive as possible, right?
But that's a lot.
Email's probably better.
Yeah, email we can do in bulk. Calling is not so easy.
I think that I would be okay taking a hardline approach if we had a system that, you know, we did a little double check. If it's not burdensome, you know, I'm not hearing that it is. We've got 20 to 40 people that... we hadn't been here from for a renewal. That doesn't seem like it's overly burdensome to, you know, a week, 2 weeks, a week before the drop dead period to send an email. But I also.
Or if we can do it, I mean, honestly, if we can do it in bulk and get into the last, you know, 5 business days prior to the end of the period, email them every day.
I'll check with.
If it keeps popping up in their inbox, maybe they'll actually pay attention.
I probably wouldn't do that. That might be.
Kind of a crazy time
yeah.
of year too. I'm
yeah.
the timing.
I personally don't
like the timing.
I do agree with that.
It's, you know, we've done work to try and make the timing consistent because in the past, the renewals were not held at a consistent time every year. So we've worked really hard to have it, you know, October, November, December. I get it. It's near Christmas.
Yeah.
You know, but there's. You know, short of sending out the renewals in September, the way the code is written, it would be hard to get it much earlier. The code.
Could you clarify? Elaborate on that?
We, from the date that we send the letter, so the date that the letters are dated.
Okay. So that's.
We have to give them 30 days.
Early October.
Right. Then from that date, they get 15 business days till the next deadline,
mm-hmm.
and then 15 business days till the next deadline.
Okay.
Well, you have a number of holidays in there, which is why it stretches from the beginning of October to the middle of December, because you've got the holidays
sure.
and the weekends.
But what prohibits us from moving this whole operation to September, September 5th, throwing out a date?
We
I don't know that
I,
we have a problem necessarily.
I'm not sure that earlier is necessarily better. Because, you know, your September, they don't expire until the end of December. So I can see people putting
yeah,
it aside.
Yeah, lost.
I think the easier, if we were going to make any change, the easier thing would be to do away with the 15 business days and have it be the first deadline is October 31st, the second deadline is November 15th, the final deadline is November 30th
mm-hmm.
or December 1st.
Yeah.
And it's just written in stone that those are the dates. None of this 15 days, 15 business days.
I would agree
days.
With that. Yeah, I don't like the 15 days.
I agree.
To me, that's... No.
Yeah, and I think if we could have the final deadline be the end of November 30th or December 1st that gets it enough away from the Christmas holidays or Hanukkah that we're not...
It'll make it easier.
Yeah.
And now that you can pay online, it's a huge improvement.
Sure.
It's much easier.
Yeah. Yeah, personally, I think going to the end of the waiting list, I think that's too harsh, personally. I think there should be a penalty,
but then
not a 7-year
the
penalty.
Second time you're going to the end of the list.
There's 1,900 other people on that list that will disagree
with you. But what about all the thousands who have their permits who, you know...
The thousands of other people that have their permits that applied, that conformed to the rules and got their renewals in on time.
We waited
years.
I know, but
you're making an exception for 6 individuals out of 5,000 people who are involved in parking in town. It's ridiculous.
But they already did wait.
I don't care.
A different opinion.
But I think
calm
this
down.
Is a
That's
silly
fine.
Conversation.
Okay.
You have the discretion. That's where I go. And I'm real.
So no policy.
I think it's really silly to have this conversation.
I don't think it's fair to the staff to have to deal with irate, crazy people coming.
You don't? You want to deal with it yourself and make a rule instead? I don't think so. I think more rules are the worst thing we could ever do. That's what we make. Government does way too much of rulemaking.
Spoken like a true Republican.
You're darn right.
I just don't want to have people coming in and having the staff be yelled at because we didn't make a
decision. Let the staff deal with it. They're adults.
Okay.
That's what they're being paid to do.
That's fine.
All righty.
I'm sorry.
Do we need to come to a decision here, though?
I think we should table this person.
All right. I think we're gonna table this issue for now. We certainly don't want to be angry amongst ourselves over this issue.
I will consider various options and give you a proposal for your next.
Could you actually? I was going to ask, what neighboring towns is there a seem to be a?
That's a good question.
You know.
So, you know, we should have that discussion to see what options, because I know one option is that we farm the whole operation out to a third party, and then we don't have any staff that has to deal with any of this, and then there is no latitude at all, right? It just is what it is. It's like I said, paying your mortgage, so.
Yep.
But we'll have that conversation.
Yep. Okay.
All right, so that one. Wait list policy is tabled, and I just added new business, discuss other issues related to parking, because I wanted to bring to your attention one of our downtown notable retailers has hired a consultant in anticipation of perceived parking challenges, downtown parking challenges, that may or may not come to pass with the redevelopment activities in the downtown. And I just want you to be aware of that. This particular retailer, their business and their parking is guided by a shared parking agreement on private property. There was some request to us, the town, to help manage the parking situation on this parcel of land that's guided by a shared parking agreement. I have made it pretty clear that the town does not enforce parking on private property. So, you know, that will be for the business of the people who are part of that agreement to work. And Jeremy, thank you for staying so late, has been engaged in these conversations, and he will be working closely with the developers to make sure that construction vehicles are parking in places that they should be parking, i.e. on the parcels of land that are owned by the people developing their projects. But we will keep our fingers carefully on the pulse of downtown parking. But there's some parking enforcement that doesn't belong in the realm of town enforcement. And Jeremy, I'm not being particularly articulate on this issue because it's late, but I don't know, maybe you could offer to us some assurance that you'll be monitoring downtown parking. We don't want our local small businesses that aren't part of this redevelopment activity to be negatively impacted by the construction.
Right, and certainly Roten Heights is kind of a test case now in terms of we have two big projects going on there all at once. Certainly nearby retailers are feeling some impacts in terms of construction vehicles, noise, the public perception that, oh, I'm not even going to Noroten Heights. So what we want to do is work with the retailers and the public and trying to make sure that people are aware, look, those businesses are still open. You may have read articles in the paper. Yeah. And, you know, that construction can be going on for a while. Those businesses are still there. And, you know, we're hoping people visit those businesses. And I think in a while, once the downtown starts going, we may have the same concerns from downtown retailers as well, in terms of, boy, it looks like a whole city block is being fenced off. And so we still have to make downtown welcoming and safe. We've worked with the building department on making sure the sidewalks have coverings and things like that, and everyone can maneuver downtown safely. But it's also, as Jamie mentioned, making sure that the construction vehicles are parked appropriately, not blocking traffic, parked in the lots they should be in. And that's certainly something we'll be sensitive to going forward, now that we've seen in Noroten Heights the concerns that are coming there and what we'll probably have downtown soon.
Correct.
May I ask a question? Most of the Darien residents don't realize that that parking lot that's between Leroy and Post, behind Darien Sport and behind the coffee shop, is private. And how, so if one of the buildings within that group were to be redeveloped, as an article that came out this weekend, how do that group get the parking? I mean, do they go to, is there a council that meets, that owns that property and talks about the prop, you know, the parking? I'm concerned if there's even less parking. Your average Darien resident, they're going downtown. Many of the parking that lot or the lot behind, you know, between Corbin and Post. But if that will be less parking with all the construction and people are going to be parking across the street now, how?
It's a good
if
question.
We don't have input into that parking lot, but yet it's going to be negatively affected if there's additional development.
Well, the you may have read in the paper the Darien Place application for 1077 Post Road, which is now the Darien Playhouse building. That's the application right down here. It's been posted online.
Yep.
And as part of that, there's a parking study done by Malone and McBroom. That public hearing before the Planning and Zoning Commission on this application, including the parking, will be March 31st. The Planning and Zoning Commission is in the process of hiring an outside consultant at the applicant's request to review this parking study and kind of get a better understanding of how it all works.
Yeah.
Certainly the public is welcome to come, anyone who has concerns, issues, nearby property owners, whoever it may be, to speak probably in this, might be in this room, at the hearing to talk about the parking question, because the Planning and Zoning Commission will have to make a finding that the parking is sufficient for the changes that are going on.
Mm-hmm. They are one of the owners of the shared parking lot, correct?
That's correct.
And it'll make a difference. You know, obviously the shared parking agreement functioned in one way with a movie theater that, you know, utilize the parking at a different time of day than traditional daytime retailers. So the tenant mix, which we don't know yet, the tenant mix will be very important to help determine what the additional impacts might be, correct?
That's correct. And one of the big selling points was having the theater, which most of its business was clearly not at the busy time.
Yeah.
The busy time, based on numerous studies we've seen, lunchtime, Thursday and Fridays. Busiest time in that parking lot and downtown in general.
Yes.
I guess a lot of people go out to lunch on those days. It's the nicest part of the day, usually the warmest part of the day, so a lot of people are out and about, and that's the busiest time.
But to clarify, what is needed from this commission, then, as a parking commission, regarding this is private property, what do we need to be?
So there's nothing that we need to do at this time for this particular parcel, but I needed to bring it to your attention because there's a lot of discussion about it in the community.
Yep.
Some people believe that we do have a role, so everybody needs to understand what we have control over. But I've spoken to Jeremy and Ed and Kate. The one thing that we could do, and I actually didn't want to do this until after Corbin development was finished, to improve our municipal parking lot wayfinding could be the one thing that we could do to help point people to the areas where they can publicly park. and that might be beneficial. So we're going to be looking at how we can sort of move up the timetable on that.
Does the state get involved in the post in this at all because of the post-road factor?
They do not. From certain standpoints, there's certain things we can't, for example, Jamie and I have had this conversation numerous times. The police cannot go out and just start striping on street parking on the post road.
Right.
As much as we would want them to do it, it's not possible. So there is a small role for the state in that on street parking, but that's just on Boston Post Road. The town controls other town roads. So you may recall a few years ago, we did some new spaces. 8 to 10 on Old Kings Highway South.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep.
And those, through the years, okay, we've all noticed more and more usage of those, which is great.
Yep.
And there's on street throughout downtown. We did 8 to 10 years ago, maybe, changed Grove Street to mm-hmm. downtown municipal parking, 2-hour parking.
Right.
Which I think it's one of those things, if people know that that's there, those in the know, so to speak, put your car there and not worry about it. It's great.
I think one thing I would be interested with more from planning and zoning, if the changes that are going to occur in this lot that we're talking about, Leroy and the Post Road, if they're going to envision looking at that lot the way the areas, I think, by Williams and Company and 1020 with a guard and Merrill, you know, with more of a, this is our spot and nobody can come in. If they're moving to that, I think that does have a huge ramifications as to how it's going to affect.
Right.
You're
the rest of the community. So I would be interested if, when you're talking about parking there, is that what they're seeing that they're going to be doing?
Well, I know.
They have a right to, but.
Again, what I've read here in this report is the fact that one of the things they've had to do was kind of chase out people who should not be in that lot, some commuters.
Right.
Some folks who may,
right, okay,
relative to your previous conversation about folks that,
didn't get the parking.
So they've had to do some enforcement. It's not really, I know I've heard many comments about the unwelcoming fact that when you're driving around near a municipal lot to have someone say, no, you can't. So we are trying very hard to get away from that. I think there will be a day in the near future, maybe in a couple years from now, where that lot no longer has that. Because mm-hmm. as part
correct.
Of the Corbin development, they're going to be redesigning that.
Right.
Yeah. We won't have that. But I don't think that's where, and I'll speak on my behalf, I don't think anyone wants to see that when you're driving looking for a parking spot where you have people say, you can't park here.
Well, we have, you know, we do see that. We have
right.
that.
Mm-hmm.
It's,
we do have
they're
that.
They're right. I mean, but.
Right. I think.
But Jeremy just said he thinks that that's going to be going
good.
Away
okay.
because
going,
it's been
yeah.
exceedingly
people would appreciate
popular.
That.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think people react better to a sign saying, hey, there's municipal parking over here,
right.
than a someone who's standing out there all day saying. So I think it's going to be an interesting public hearing for the commission to try to sort this out.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly the theater is just, the theater building is just one piece to this whole puzzle.
Yep.
Certainly the Corbin development, which will, that project will be starting this spring, where some of the buildings on, I'll call it the north or east side of Corbin, will start getting taken down and rebuilt. We'll start,
mm-hmm.
have to focus, and I've spoken to David Genovese of Baywater Properties numerous times, and we've had numerous conversations about making sure he can park his construction vehicles and his workers appropriately,
correct.
Not to impact others.
Correct. Okay, so I just wanted to make sure you're all aware that that is a conversation that's ensuing at the moment. We will move on to approval of the minutes of our September 9th parking meeting, if we can remember what we said in September.
Well, only two of you were there.
Yeah.
Okay. So the rule is you can vote if you weren't in the meeting. You could still vote on the minutes if you feel that they are correct. But you are under no obligation to do so.
Even though we weren't members of this body,
yeah.
can we
yeah.
thing?
So we
don't.
Yeah, we won't have a quorum then. To
you don't need a quorum
need
to
a,
vote.
Oh, you don't.
You just
okay.
need a majority.
All right. All right.
Or you just need if you know, 203 would pass them.
Two
in favor, zero opposed, three abstentions would pass the minutes.
Okay.
And honestly, you know,
okay.
they can stay in draft form forever too.
Okay.
Not a big deal.
All right. Then I'll entertain a motion to approve the September 9th, 2019 special meeting parking authority minutes.
Kip, I would hope that you would.
With just the one addition of the word side.
The word what?
Remember on page one, Tokenique Road, each side.
Oh, you're right, right. Each side of the road.
Okay. Other than that,
on each of the road. Yeah.
Each side of the road.
Yeah.
We're good.
Okay. All right. As amended then?
Yes.
Kip moves. Anybody interested in seconding? I will second. Okay. All those in favor? Two in favor. Those opposed? Those abstain? Okay, there you go. All right. Entertain a motion to adjourn our parking authority meeting.
So moved.
Sarah, may I have a second?
Yep.
Krista, all those in favor? Okay. Thank